got no minutes.
Good morning, Cornerstone. Everybody ready? Let's start with the song this morning. Come people of the risen King.
Come to do that this morning, to rejoice. Let's all wave at each other, then you may be seated. We have several announcements this morning that we need you to listen to. One of the things that's really devastating to me and my whole identity as a person is that people just don't listen to announcements, and so it's really crushing if people don't listen. So please listen carefully. We'll go through them as quickly as we can. Number one, please silence your cell phone so that we can go through the worship service uninterrupted. Number two, you'll notice in your bulletin there's a blue sheet. We hope that you will fill out the appropriate information there. And then on the back side is a place to put your prayer requests. And so please make sure you do that. And tomorrow the staff will get together and pray specifically for those needs. Number three, there's an envelope in your bulletin. We encourage people at Cornerstone to fast one meal a week and take the proceeds from that meal, which we hope that you'll eat at Ruth Chris or one of those places, and then take the money that you would normally spend there and put it in the envelope on Sunday, and then that goes to feed hungry people all across the world. At the last missions committee meeting, we got to the fasting funds, and I was amazed how much money is generated by this one little act of sacrifice. And so please make sure that you do that. Now, First of all, next week, we had planned originally for the ordination service to be on the 16th, but we rescheduled that. So next Sunday morning, January the 30th, we will ordain the 2022 leadership team at Cornerstone. So please make sure that you are here next Sunday morning for a part of that. Then also, we will also set apart Steve as the senior minister for Cornerstone. And so we will be doing that next Sunday as well. And then following that, we will have a potluck dinner, a church fellowship dinner to welcome Steve and his family in that role. So there's a sign-up sheet in the back for bringing food for the potluck dinner next week. So please make sure on your way out this morning, you stop by that table to sign up what you're going to be bringing, because we don't just want all mashed potatoes and none of the other stuff. So please make sure you sign up for certain items. So there's a great opportunity to have muy bueno food next Sunday. So don't forget to sign up at the sign-up table at the end of the service this morning. There will be a deacons meeting following the worship service today. So all you deacons meeting, please be aware of that. And then also at the back table where Karen is sitting, there are giving records for 2021. It saves us a stamp. If you would just pick that up on the way out this morning, you get your giving records, please make sure that you do that. There is a congregational meeting immediately following the worship service today. We have had a lot happen in a week's time. A lot of wonderful things have happened this week. We have had people in our church family who have been working incessantly to get ready for the meeting this morning, who have done yeoman's work all week long. We think we have found a piece of property, and we're trusting that God's going to work all this out. And we want to share all the information that we know to make sure that you're up to speed on this. And I'm pretty excited, and it's been 16 years. And so I just hope that you'll stay afterwards for the meeting, and Steve and his crew is going to lead us in that. So please make sure you make that a priority after the worship service this morning. Today is a special day, a day that we connect with Thrive, who is one of the missions of our church. So if you would please take your attention to the screen, and then Priscilla Beta will be giving an announcement following this.
My father was pregnant. Everything got a little dark. I was thinking, you know, abortion. So I started looking up some clinics.
You know, she showed me the pregnancy test, and, you know, my heart dropped a little bit. I was like, is this for real? A part of me was nervous, part of me was excited, but I left that decision to her.
I wasn't raised that way as far as having that kind of thought. I was just really kind of thinking about myself. Called around, and then I called Thrive. It was just a good feeling over the phone, and it just made me wanna, okay, this is where I'll choose to go.
From the time we went, I was real nervous because we still hadn't decided. It's a tough decision, you know, being able to take, you know, an unborn child's life, you know, having to live with that for the rest of your life, so.
I waited for one of the ladies to come inside and to speak with me. Inside of that room, when she was speaking to me, she had all these pamphlets going towards, you know, Christian-like and, you know, spiritual, you know, what life would be, you know, with a baby. And when she was speaking to me about God, I felt his presence there. And it was a crazy feeling when she left the room. Before, it was dark, like I said, and the light just kind of lit up in the room. And there was a chair sitting next to me, and I just felt God was just sitting there and just letting me know that he was there, and like he was just telling me that this was for you. This is what I have for you. And everything was gonna be okay. So it definitely made me change my mind just being in that room. It definitely made me change my mind. So I met Miss Meredith. I think maybe I was around 4 to 5 weeks, and I just seen this little itty bitty tiny rice grain on there, and I just got super emotional. It was just so close, it was so little, and it was just something that I got emotional about, because it's just, it's another life. It's another life that's inside you.
After we went through the sonogram, she did pray with us, and she read us some scriptures, obviously brought us close to God and showed us where we needed to be. Afterwards, I think that was the best moment, you know, when she was able to actually counsel us through this decision that we ended up making, which is to have our son.
We were just like, we're so glad that we took this route, because little Junior, Devontae Junior, would not be here. And I looked at my son and I just smiled so big. Like, I'm just so glad that God just redirected me and just made me do what I needed to do. And that was to have him. That was to bring him in this world. So we have some good news. I am no longer a girlfriend. I am a fiance. So within the 4 to 5 weeks, we chose life.
Awesome sauce.
It's the best thing that ever happened to me. It's peace and it's love.
Thank you. That was Netta and Devontae's story, and that is very typical. I'd like to say it happens all the time. It doesn't. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Priscilla Badup, and I'm here representing Thrive Women's Clinic. This has been something that is near and dear to my heart. And we've been representing Thrive here at Cornerstone probably since the beginning of Cornerstone. It was originally Dallas Pregnancy Resource Center and has been in existence for over 30 years. I brought a lot of brochures in the back, and I wanted to tell you more about what's going on. There have been a lot of changes this year. We have a new executive director, Lisa Freeman. I've met her. She's very, very nice. I'm going to be spending some time with her on Thursday this week, too. I'm very excited about that. She used to be head of Preston Woods Pregnancy Center. And in the past, most recently, she had a Cuban church outreach ministry where she headed up development efforts as well. And she was serving in various roles, including animal rescue groups, and now God has brought her back to pro-life movement. She has a lot of good ideas, and we are very excited about what's going on. You might think that because abortion rights have changed in Texas, what do we do now? Well, it's even more important, because time is of the essence. And it's very easy to pick up the phone and make an appointment right over the border for an abortion. And that's what our clients are doing every day. And so it's real important to get them in fast. And so we have appointments every hour on the hour. And on Tuesdays when I go, I see somebody possibly, if they come, excuse me, at 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, and it's very hard. I need more volunteers. So I'm gonna tell y'all a little bit about what I do. My mentor told me, I've been there for 7 years, and my mentor told me originally, I was scared to death. I learned the book, it's about like that. I learned it as much as I could. It's been a long time since I've been in school. And she said, what you need to do is be their great aunt that they haven't seen and show them the love of Jesus like they have never seen it before. Love on them like they've never been loved before. And that's what you do. You love them. You show them the love of Jesus. You talk to them about their story. What brought them there? Why are they there? A lot of them want to have their baby, but a lot of them don't. So why is that? Some of them just because they can't, they don't think they can afford it. Or they just had a baby a year ago, and they don't think they can afford another one. They don't know how much they can play together. They don't know it's not as expensive the second time if they're that close together, especially if they're the same sex. What can be done for them? We know those things. We have the ideas that they don't. We can get them connected. We know all those things. We can make appointments for them. We have brochures. We send them away with brochures that they have never seen before. And it's amazing. I have a lot of these things in the back. I wish I'd had some of these when I was pregnant. I was never pregnant. But when I had a baby that was given to me, and I had no clue as to what to do with it. So Thrive is an incredible resource. Most of you in this room are not going to be having any babies given to you in the near future, but you might know someone that is. Remember Thrive. We have so many resources, and we need your help, not just financially, but we need volunteers. It's a wonderful place to serve. The other day, a girl came in. We'll call her Susan. Susan came in, and she had never been to church before. I was able to share with her the gospel. We do that with every client. We can tell them we don't get funding from the government. People give us money to exist, to share with them, to give sonograms to people that are needing it. There's various reasons for that. And churches, and they light up and they go, churches give you money? I was like, yes, they do. And they're real excited to hear that government doesn't give them money. And so we say, so we get money from churches. So we can talk to you about your life with God. How do you feel about God? Do you talk to God? And you talk to them about that. You talk to them about their personal relationship with God. Do they believe? What about Jesus? You go through the steps. You give them the gospel. I do it every client, every Tuesday. And Susan had never been to church, ever, her whole life. She had never heard the gospel. She believed in God. She believed in Jesus. Her dad had talked to her about it. But I was able to share with her, she accepted Jesus as her personal Lord and Savior. It's a wonderful feeling. It still gives me goosebumps. I do it all the time. You can too. It's wonderful. We don't only save babies, but we save lives. So I thank you so much for allowing me to serve. Our Thrive puts out a newsletter. It's a brochure, book, another one, a booklet. And we do it quarterly. And they love our church so much that this quarter on the centerfold, and I have those, if you haven't seen this, this is about Cornerstone. And all of y'all on this side of the room, you're in this picture. it talks about your church is coming to life, Cornerstone Christian Church. And so they love our church. And we appreciate you so very much. Thank you. Get your bottles, fill them up.
We're going to encourage everybody this year to go on a mission trip. If you haven't been on a mission trip, representing Cornerstone and representing our Lord, we encourage you to do that. But the wonderful thing about taking a mission trip, it's just down on Garland Road or across the street. You don't have to go to another country. You don't have to go to Guatemala. You don't have to go to Mexico. You don't have to go to the Ukraine. You can just get in your car and drive across the street. And that's the beauty of it. So we hope that this year that you would do that. Let's pray together, and then we'll continue our worship. Father, we thank you for the fact that the creatures are home. We're thankful, Lord, that they're watching this morning, and we thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to that you've extended to them for the last several months. We pray, Lord, your protection over them. We pray that you'll help Micah to completely and totally recover. We pray you'll bless the family as they quarantine, and that you'll bless Michael as he goes back to work. Father, we thank you for Thrive today and pray your blessing on this mission, on the people that save lives, babies that will someday be in heaven. And we're thankful, Lord, that we can be a part of that. Father, we pray for Bob Meskin, who's in the hospital today, and just ask that you'll heal him. We pray for Bob Myers, Lord, that you'll intervene in his life and help him, Lord. We pray, Lord, for Stacy Ringer, and thank you for the successful surgery that she had, and we pray that you'll sustain her during the chemo and radiation. Father, we pray for Mike Baumgartner today, that you'll help him. And Lord, I just thank you for the developments that have happened this past week. I thank you for so many people who've worked so very hard. And we pray, Lord, that you'll make it abundantly clear what you've called us to do. Father, we pray that you'll speak to us this morning as we honor you, as we worship you. And we thank you so much for Jesus and the change that he's made in each of us. And we pray, Lord, today as we share these moments together, that you'll flood our minds and our hearts with memories of what we used to be like and how you've changed us. We are so grateful, Lord, and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's stand, shall we?
You know, life is precious, and that's the reason why it's important to save these babies. Every single person is created in God's image. Every single person. And because God's image is in every person, that life has value no matter what. No matter where they come from, no matter their station in life, no matter how they came about, their life has value. But because Jesus gave his life for ours, our life now has double value because we have been now purchased at the price of blood. And because of that, we now live. We live for real. Amen. Thank you.
needed rescue. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life. Grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Chains are a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, laid on a criminal's cross, and darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life is over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on
Amen. You may be seated.
This morning's scripture is Colossians 3, 1 through 4. Since then you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory.
God, you brought us out of the wilderness. Oh, rejoice. My heart will always sing. Let our wandering souls in your faithfulness, oh, rejoice. My heart will always sing. Praise the Lord, oh, my soul.
Praise upon praise, let all that is within me praise. love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Let's sing I Love You, Lord again.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Why?
So my life you have been faithful.
So loving, God, and you deserve every ounce of our praise for every minute of our life. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come this morning thankful for the many blessings you bestowed upon us this week, and we just ask now that as you've laid upon Steve's heart the message that he's to deliver us, open our hearts and minds so that we'll be receptive to what you have for us. Guide us and direct us through this day, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. This church in Thessalonica that we've been talking about for the last couple of weeks, I just keep marinating on this this quality of a church. What an amazing church it must have been for everybody to look up to that church. I marvel at the idea that something like that made it into Scripture, that there is this church that is just doing such a great job and being such a great example to the other churches in the area. And I have to wonder, how does that happen? How does a church become like that? How does a church become the kind of thing that everybody else looks up to? How does a church become such a thing that others ought to emulate? What goes into making a church like that? You know, Paul describes some of the characteristics that they have, but as part of the church of the modern world, as part of the church today, I want to know, what goes into making a church like that? How do you grow a church that way? When you share the gospel, how does it hit that way? You're all familiar with that saying that behind a great man stands a great woman, right? And all the female voices go, yes. And then 2 seconds later, all the men go, oh, yeah, yeah. This reveals something. Not the fact that the men took longer to say yes. The idea that whenever you see something great, there's something great behind it as well. And I think that as a church today, when we want to have that same impact in people's lives, so that in the future, not only can we say about Cornerstone, but can we say about the people that Cornerstone harvests for God's kingdom, that we can say of those people and we can say of Cornerstone, you are exemplary. So we want to achieve that. And in order for that, I think it's important that we see what Paul says is the reason why this has happened. So I'd like to ask you all to turn your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians 2, and we will read the first 8 verses. This is what Paul says, "For you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and been shamefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. For our appeal does not spring from error or impurity or any attempt to deceive, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak, not to please man, but to please God, who tests our hearts. For we never came with words of flattery, as you know, nor with a pretext for greed. God is witness. Nor did we seek glory from people, whether from you or from others, though we could have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nursing mother taking care of her own children. So being affectionately desirous of you, we were ready to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you had become very dear to us. Earlier, Paul had described what a great church Thessalonica was. And he then begins to explain why Thessalonica is a great church. Not the whole why, but a critical ingredient. You notice that Paul begins by saying for. And for is a way that we say because. This is the reason for what we said earlier. And so Paul in chapter 1 talks about what a great church Thessalonica was. Because you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain, and so on and so on. And there are three different things that Paul attributes to part of the reason why the church in Thessalonica was such a great church. He does it in this formula that he repeats three times. There are these statements that he uses, three different statements, and he repeats the same formula every time. It begins with for. And then there's a statement with a but, as in, not this, but this, and then to. In other words, in order to accomplish something. So the reason is because, not this, but this, in order to this. Does that make sense? So there's this formula of for, but, to. I'd like to read the first part of this section real quick. For you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain, but though we had already suffered and been shamefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. Thessalonica is a great church, for the missionary work that went there was not empty, but instead was resilient and courageous because of God's power to declare God's gospel. That's the first one. When Paul comes to Thessalonica, they have been pretty mistreated at Philippi. Verbally, legally, even physically mistreated as they were trying to share the gospel at Philippi. And in those conditions, they arrived in Thessalonica where they met much of the same resistance. But even though they had suffered all those things, the faith that Paul and that his missionary team had when they got to Thessalonica was they had this hardened faith. And because they had this hardened faith, they were able to be courageous. And even though they were meeting a lot of obstacles and a lot of opposition, they still went forward with the gospel despite all the opposition. And we're not only talking about rhetorical opposition. Much of the opposition that Paul and his team faced was not just rhetorical, it was often legal, it was political, and it was physical. And despite all of that, Paul says, we were bold in God to preach the gospel to you. And I love the fact that Paul says that we were bold in God because there has to be something that justifies the boldness. When you do something, when you're bold about something, there has to be something to back it up. You have to back up the goods. Otherwise, being bold is just being reckless. If you don't have something that underwrites your boldness, then you're not being bold, you're just being reckless. But Paul says, when they got there, they found opposition, but they were bold. In other words, they did not hold back. They continued to preach the gospel in the face of the opposition, knowing that they were doing so at great risk. But what was underwriting their boldness? What gave them the ability to be courageous? Well, they were relying on the power and on the promise of God. God underwrites the courage of real witnesses who face opposition. God underwrites the courage of real witnesses who face opposition. So that when someone is sharing the gospel and they get pushback, no matter how hard the pushback is, a real witness, someone who has real confidence, whose faith is real and hardened, can always lean back on the power that God gives and on the power of His promise to be bold and to speak without fear, or rather to speak despite fear. He gives another statement. For our appeal does not spring from error or impurity or any attempt to deceive. But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak, not to please man, but to please God who tests our hearts. In other words, for the missionaries' encouragement to the Thessalonians to faith, to come into faith, it's not motivated by some of these pernicious things that we often see, like deception or sexual immorality or an attempt to defraud them out of their money. None of those things were the motivation for the missionaries encouraging the Thessalonians to adopt the faith. But having been tried and attested by God, they were entrusted with this gospel, not to please men, but to please God. So this is another one of the reasons why the church in Thessalonica was so successful, was because those who brought the gospel were not coming at them with bad motivations, as is often the case. When people come to persuade you about something, whether it's in politics or in religion or in sales, there's always a motive, right? And the ones that make the news are the ones that have the worst motives. Those are the ones that we find out were doing some pretty dirty, nasty things. But Paul says, we didn't come to you with any of those motives. Instead, having been tested by God. And when Paul talks about being tested, he talks about being tested by being used. There's this parable that Jesus gave in one of the Gospels where a king is going to have this wedding for his son, and he invites all the people. And then all of a sudden, when he tells his servants to go tell the people that everything's ready for the wedding, he goes to one of them and he says, the feast is ready, so you need to come. And the guy goes, as it turns out, I just bought seven, what does he call them? Plows or something like that. And I need to go test them. Meaning, I need to go use them to see if they work. So he made that excuse to not go to the wedding. But that word testing by using something to see if it works, that's what Paul is talking about. We've been put through our paces. Our faith has been put to the test. And because we have been tested, we're now attested and entrusted by God for the gospel. Meaning that when Paul came to the Thessalonians and said, hey, we come to you and we're bringing you this transformational gospel. The reason they can say that is because they've experienced it. They have been transformed. Paul has been dramatically transformed. So when he talks about a transforming faith, he knows exactly what he's talking about because he's been through it. He has experienced it. So missionaries' encouragement to faith is not motivated by deception or sexual immorality or fraud, but having been tried and attested by God, are entrusted with this gospel. And here's the interesting thing, not to please men, but to please God. And it's always important to recognize who you work for, right? We have this saying in Spanish, nadie sabe para quién trabaja. Nobody knows who they work for. Because sometimes you strive really hard to do something and then somebody else reaps the benefit from it. So nobody knows who they work for, right? That's kind of how life goes so much of the time. And it's very important that as a church that we recognize who we work for, who we serve. We do not serve man, but we serve God. And by not serving man, what Paul means is he's not serving the Thessalonians, and he's not serving himself either. He's not there for his benefit. He's there for the glory of God. Listen to what Paul says in a different place in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. He says, examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Or do you not realize this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you? Unless, indeed, you fail to meet the test. I can't emphasize how important this is. Because when we approach somebody with the gospel, and we encourage people to commit to the faith, they want to know, but does it work? When you speak to me of a transformational faith, I want to know, does it work? Has it been tested before? And Paul says, because we were tested. We were tested, our faith was used, it was put through the ringer, and it came out the other side, and our lives had been transformed. So we know that it works. There's a third statement that he makes. For we never came with words of flattery, as you know, nor with a pretext for greed. God is witness. Nor did we seek glory from people, whether from you or from others, though we could have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nursing mother taking care of her own children, so being affectionately desirous of you, we were ready to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you had become very dear to us. I'd like to put this a little bit differently to summarize it. Because missionaries did not offer flattery or seek personal gain, and of this God is witness, but demonstrated a maternal gentleness towards Thessalonians in order to share God's gospel, but also themselves. I'd like to read what Paul writes in a different place in Colossians 1:24. Give us an idea of what Paul means by this maternal tenderness. He says, now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of this body that is the church. Let me read you another one, this time from the Apostle Peter. 1 Peter 4:13. but rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Fruitful faith is watered by the planter's blood, sweat, and tears. When we plant a seed of faith, that seed only grows and bears fruit when it is watered by the planter's blood, sweat, and tears. That's why Paul says that it's not only that we came to you with a resilient faith that rested on God's power to be courageous. It's not only that we can give you our own experience that this faith is real, that it is transformational, but we also, on top of that, on top of giving you what God sent us to give you, we put our own skin in the game. We cried for you. We worked for you. We invested ourselves personally in you. Essentially, what these things suggest is that this is what willing people in God's hands can do for God. When you have an exemplary church like Thessalonica, what goes into making a church like that, no doubt, has a lot to do with how Thessalonica takes the gospel. It's a big part of it. But it's also about the person who gives the gospel, how they give the gospel. How much you are invested in making sure that that seed will germinate and grow and bear fruit. There's a big difference between the way Paul shared the gospel and the way Jonah went to Nineveh to warn them about the coming judgment. You guys remember how Jonah preached? It was the shortest sermon in the world. He walked through the city and just said, God's going to destroy this place. Done. That was it. He didn't care if anybody responded. One of the marvelous things about the book of Jonah is the fact that the Ninevites did respond, despite such a lousy way of preaching. But this is not the way that Paul shares the gospel in Thessalonica. And here's the hard part about this, is that then we begin to wonder, well, I mean, gosh, that was Paul. That was Paul. Like, how can we still, can we imitate what Paul did? Can we replicate the things that Paul did? Well, here's the interesting thing about all of this. Even as Paul is talking about the things that he and his missionary team did, I don't know if you picked up on this, but he keeps pointing to God. Even as he's describing what he and his team did, he keeps pointing to God. No less than 7 times does Paul point to God in the response to all of this stuff. God is the one who underwrites the boldness. Without God's power and without his promise of their life secured in heaven, without that, there's no reason to be bold about the gospel. But because God underwrites that courage, they're able to be bold. The gospel is not theirs. The gospel is God's. It is God's gospel that we have come to share. We did not take up this career on our own. We were approved by God. And that word approved is where we get the term tested from. He's approved because he was tested and approved. He passed the test. So it is God who selects those who are going to serve God's gospel. And it is God who will underwrite their courage so that they may be bold in the face of opposition. It is God who is our client when we do the work of evangelism and of missions. God is witness to our inmost motivations. Whatever the world thinks is our motive, doesn't matter. God knows what our motive is. And it is Christ who sends us out. And so really, even though Paul is talking about the things that he and his team did, really the only reason they did all the things that they did is because God. He gives you the message. He selects you to take the message. He underwrites your courage. And he knows your motivations. Doesn't matter what anybody else says. But these are some pretty essential conditions for developing a church and developing a faith in someone else that can be exemplary. Now, I want to be very careful to point out, I'm not saying, Paul isn't saying that this is the secret to success. This is not the secret sauce of evangelism or of missionary work. Paul used the exact same tactics and operated with the exact same values everywhere. But the result wasn't the same everywhere. Paul used these same values when he went to the church in Corinth. And Corinth was far from an exemplary church. He used these same tactics and values when he went to preach the gospel in Athens. And there was no church in Athens. This isn't a silver bullet. We are still dealing with people who have free will. All this is a way to make sure that you have done your best effort in making sure that that seed is planted, that it germinates, that it grows and bears much fruit. And so I wonder, what do we need to do? What does the modern church today, what does this church need to do in order to make sure that we've done everything that is within our power, which God has given us, to give people the most chance to have a fruitful faith? Well, if we take Paul's three statements, here's the first one. Harden your faith. Harden your faith. We can't have jello faith. It needs to be hard. It needs to be so hard that when the world throws stuff at it, the stuff breaks, not the faith. Your faith has to be hard. Because opposition will present itself. There will be conflict. And you have to have the courage to blast through it. And that courage doesn't come from the fact that you're just so awesome. That courage comes from the fact that no matter what happens, God's word is good. Your life, your real life, is secure in Him. Who cares if somebody tells you to fly a kite? So harden your faith. Make it resilient. Here's the second thing. That resilient faith that you have, use it on yourself. Use it on yourself. Let your life be transformed so that when you go somewhere and you offer this transforming faith, this life-altering relationship with Christ, so that you can say, trust me, it works. It worked on me. My life has been transformed. I gave my life over to Christ, and it's totally different from what it was before. There's a real transformation. And if there is no transformation, then we tend to not have as much confidence in that faith. And so we don't tend to offer as powerful a faith as we ought to. We end up offering like a self-help faith. And that's not the faith we were given. So we use the faith on ourselves. We are tested. God does put us through our paces. He exercises us in order to see, is this faith working in you? So use your faith on yourself. And lastly, we need to put skin in the game. We cannot just serve the food and give someone the plate of faith. We need to sit down and share the meal with them. If that makes any sense. Paul and his team were personally invested in those strangers from Thessalonica. He says, you became so dear to us. We know God loves you. That's why He sent His Son to die. And we love God. And because we love God, that's why we're being obedient and we're coming to speak to you. But you know what? We love you too. God loves you, we love God, and we love you. So this gospel that I'm coming to share, I'm not just going to leave it and then walk away and then see what happens. I'm going to hang around. And I know that you might mistreat me sometime. And I'm committing right now that I'll take it. And I'll come back for more. If that's what it takes for that seed to grow, I will take it. I will sweat for you. And I will cry for you. And this is what Paul has done. This is what Paul has invested in this group of people. And this thing just blew up. I want to invite us all today to make this our approach to carrying out the mission that is still left to do. Harden your faith. Apply the transformational faith to yourself. And put some skin in the game. And the Lord will do what the Lord will do at that point. Amen. Will you please stand with me and let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we know, Lord, that you desire everybody to come to the knowledge of Christ. You desire everybody to repent. And we know, Lord, that it is our love for you that motivates us to speak on your behalf and to share the gospel. We know that it is you that we ought to please and not men and not ourselves. We know, Father, that the promises that you have made us are secure and they are trustworthy. And we can have full confidence in them. But Lord, I ask this morning that you would help us to really internalize these things. That these things that we know would grow to give us the confidence to step out of comfort, to invest these things into the people that are around us, that we would then take these things and share them with the world, that we would invest in people that need to be saved. Lord, that we ourselves would be first transformed so that we can speak of what we know, so that our life can be an example. Test us, Father. Test us and make our faith tempered and strong, that we may be able to share it. I pray this all in your Son, Jesus' name.
Eternal God, unchanging, mysterious and unknown. Your boundless love, unfailing, in grace and mercy shown. Bright seraphim in ceaseless flight around your glory. Yes, throne, they raise their voices day and night in praise to you alone. Hallelujah, glory be to our great God. Hallelujah, glory be. Pray.
and every flying bird. Let every mountain, every field, and valley of the earth. Let all the moons and all the stars in all the universe sing praises to the living God.
Have a seat. Have to unlock my Bible. Wonderful. I remember when they had pages. I'm old. In the opening scenes of Fiddler on the Roof, it's coming up to sundown, and the Sabbath is about to begin. And everyone is in a hurry to get home and get to the table before the sun sets. And in this scene, you see that going from house to house to house, the women lighting the candles. The family gathers around the table, and the meal can begin. They gathered at sundown. We're more on the other end of the day. 15 hours ago, the sun was coming up in Papua New Guinea, and people were gathering for worship there. And many of them just like us, somewhere in their service, gather around a table. And we remember. We remember what God has done for us. We come together to collectively thank Him and just remember that we are in the redeemed. Luke 22:14 and following. Now, when the hour came, Jesus took his place at the table, and the apostles joined him. And he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. He knew what was coming, and he wanted to have a meal with the people who were closest to him. And he invited us to join in that meal. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. Then he took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. And so, following the sun around this planet, people have gathered around the table to share in this meal. You look at it and you say, it's an awfully small meal. But remember, Jesus is the feast. This is the remembrance. Help us, Lord, to remember. Blessed are you, O God, who brings forth bread from the earth and the fruit of the vine. Thank you that in these simple elements we can remember what you have done for us and redeemed us into your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. He took the bread and gave thanks and said, take, eat. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup and said, this is the new covenant in my blood. Drink it and remember me. Thank you, in Jesus' name.
Doesn't it just blow your mind that a letter that was written 2,000 years ago still means something to us today? My goodness, what a wonderful thing, and how God uses people who just sit down to write notes and change people forever. What a wonderful thing. Thank you for being here this morning. We invite you to stay for the congregational meeting that's immediately to follow. Let's pray and then we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you for Paul speaking to us today through Steve. We thank you, Lord, for your word that is living and active and pierces our hearts and causes us, Lord, to want to trust you more. And we pray this week that you will help us to be your ambassadors as we step into a world that's full of darkness as we bear your light. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege of getting to do that. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you have blood pressure,